Which means there's only one more week of school left. So I'm sure parents are looking forward to next weekend where they'll have their children to themselves for 2 whole weeks. Yes, the government babysitting service shuts for a fortnight, so you're on your own with your children. So I hope you look forward to that. And of course, our secondary school teachers will finish at 10 past one on Friday, whereas our primary school teachers will finish at 3, so they will struggle on to 3. And I can tell you, having worked in schools for many years, that Friday afternoon can be a long afternoon, but there'll be a lot of high-quality videos being played with great educational content to keep everybody interested in their education. We're delighted this morning to have Adrian along from Compassion UK. Great to see you, Adrian. Thanks for coming along. All the way from Dunfermline, so well done to you from the Kingdom of Fife. Great to see you, and we're looking forward to your presentation a little bit later on. In the theme of compassion, I'm going to read Psalm 103, which says, "Praise for the Lord's mercies." And it's a psalm of David. And of course, David, the great king of Israel, he knew a lot about the mercy and compassion of God, because David got so many things wrong in his life and had to rely on the mercy and the compassion of God. And I'm sure that's something that we can all identify with. "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits. Who forgives all your iniquities, who heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from destruction, who crowns you with loving kindness and tender mercies, who satisfies your mouth with good things so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. The Lord executes righteousness and justice for all who are oppressed. He made known his ways to Moses, his acts to the children of Israel. The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in mercy. He will not always strive with us, nor will he keep his anger forever. He has not dealt with us according to our sins, nor punished us according to our iniquities. For as the heavens are high above the earth, so great is his mercy towards those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. As a father pities his children, so the Lord pities those who fear him. For he knows our frame. He remembers that we are dust. As for man, his days are like the grass. As a flower of the field, so he flourishes, for the wind passes over it and it is gone, and its place remembers it no more. But the mercy of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting on those who fear him, and his righteousness to children's children, to such as keep his covenant, and to those who remember his commandments to do them. The Lord has established his throne in heaven, and his kingdom rules over all. Bless the Lord, you his angels, who excel in strength, who do his word, heeding the voice of his word. Bless the Lord, all you his hosts, you ministers of his who do his pleasure. Bless the Lord, all his works, in all places of his dominion. Bless the Lord, O my soul." Amen. Let's pray together. Father, we come to you this morning as the great God, the mighty God, the God of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, who from generation to generation has looked after his people. And Father, for that we are very glad, and we're very glad that, Lord, we heard that message. That message of love and forgiveness and compassion, which you revealed fully in the life and the death and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And Father, we're glad for those generations of people who went before us, who made great sacrifices to ensure that we could hear that message and could come into this covenant of grace and mercy. We thank you this morning that you forgive all our sins, that you heal all our diseases, that you redeem our lives from destruction, that you crown us with loving kindness and tender mercies, and that you satisfy us with good things so that our strength is renewed like the eagles. And Father, as we come to you today, we want to tell you that we love you, and we thank you for sending Jesus, and we thank you for the power of your Holy Spirit which dwells within each one who believes in Christ. And Father, as we come to you today, we ask that you would pour out your Holy Spirit afresh upon us. We thank you, Lord, that you came to live in us by the power of your Spirit. And we pray as we sing your praise, as we worship you, as we listen to your word, and as we pray to you. And everything that goes on this morning might be to your glory and to your praise. Amen.
just going to sing two songs together. The second one, if you don't know it, just join in when you can. But please stand to sing.
Stars they went, the morning sun was dead, the savior of the world night was falling, his body on the cross, his blood poured out for us, the weight of every curse upon him.
To be together, and we're about to just have a presentation from Adrian, or a conversation, an interview with Adrian in a minute, and we just felt that might be a little long for the kids. So boys and girls, you're invited to go early out to your kids group. You're going to be learning through in your group while we kind of hear a bit about the boys and girls around the world, actually, who get the kind of support that you don't always get every single day through the local church, and just showing that compassion that God has. So I'm going to invite you just to go now, if that's okay. I know there's, if I could play a tune, I'd play one for you, but yeah, and dance a bit as well. Thank you, guys. Thanks, Ruth. It's impressive that he woke up and he's in that good a mood. Very impressed. Good, thanks for that. So just appreciating the next 10 minutes, Adrian and I are just going to have a chat as he explains the work of compassion. It's great to know the character of God, as Willem introduced us with that Psalm 103 about the compassion of God. And it's great actually to have the opportunity to have Adrian with us. He is the Senior Partnerships Manager in Scotland for Compassion UK. And as a church, I've been discovering the long connection that we have with compassion. Not only do a number of us in the church support individuals, but also the Ladies Together group have recently, I think, their kid graduated at 18 and had faithfully supported that child throughout the years in the ladies group. And so we really love to see that. So Adrian, I'm just going to invite you to come up. And I've got a few questions and I'm just going to ask you. So tell us how COVID pandemic has impacted the work of compassion and what opportunities are there?
Good morning. Nice to be with you. You think how challenging it's been for us and for our children. Certainly through the kind of first lockdown, it would have been hard for our kids. But you can imagine these kids in some of these developing countries where this little boy is from in Uganda. They were locked in a room maybe 10 by 12 with no electricity, no water, no Wi-Fi. My goodness, life without Wi-Fi. They probably would be more content than some of our children or my grandchildren. They're quite resilient, you know. They cope well. They've had to deal with things like SARS and Ebola in Africa. But it makes a difference. And I want to say that coming to the church, the local church, to you, to try and convey that story, it's not the easiest thing in the world when we sit in relative comfort and we don't really want for a terrific amount, but they're content. And that's an amazing story. When I was out in Uganda, that little boy you just saw, he's on his mother's knee there, I spotted him in a project that we'd visited, and I'd said to the people there, does this little boy have a sponsor? I mean, there are 260 million children in the world in poverty, and that number doesn't really register with me, Rab, but one child does. And I said, has he got a sponsor? And they said, no, he doesn't have a sponsor. So I thought, we're already sponsoring a few children. I'll text my wife. Now, if you knew my wife, if I text her in the next room, there's no guarantee I'll get an answer in 24 hours, even in the next room. So I texted her. I said, look, could we sponsor another child? And being a good, obedient husband, I thought, I can't do this without her agreement. But we were leaving that project, and I thought, she'll be all right. I'll have a good sponsor. £28, you know, changed his life forever. So I sponsored him on our behalf, and I thought I would seek forgiveness when I got home. And about an hour later, believe it or not, into Africa, I get a text which just said, okay. Oh dear. And then I confessed my sin when I got home. I'd done it without her permission. But the impact of COVID has been softened by the support of churches, the local church, people like you. I know you've been involved in financing or supporting, I think it's 19 mothers in a project in Uganda where it's just made things a little bit easier for 19 mothers. And I think you raised so many thousands of pounds and it would go into the support of those mothers during their pregnancy and during their delivery, which is a real challenge in Africa. As you can imagine, so many botched deliveries through unprofessional people or non-medical people carrying out these deliveries, or women hemorrhaging and dying, just commonplace in Africa. But as a result of the support that you've given, this church has given, 19 mothers have gone through our program there in that church. And it's been easier through COVID for them. So it's not easy generally, but the support that we give as the local church has made a difference. So the answer, a long answer to a short question, the answer is it's tough, it's been tough, But because of the work that we do in many of these projects and the work that you help us fund, it's been just a little bit more bearable for a lot of people.
Thanks, Adrian. And what's it like for the kids who are involved in the Compassion Program?
Again, it's amazing. One of the things we do, folks, if you don't know, actually, can you just pause that for a second? That's 1 sec. Sorry, thanks. So one of the things we do is we try and connect an individual or a family with a child in a project. And I'll mention something about that in a moment, if I may. But there's a little short video here I'd like to show you about an English couple that went out to visit their sponsored child in Africa. And I just want you to look at the look on the man's face when he meets the sponsored child for the first time. They've been sponsoring this girl, Violet, since she was 2, and she's now 14. And that's what we try and cultivate in Compassion, a relationship between a sponsor and a child whose life we can save and change. So sorry, if we could just roll that video, that'd be great.
I believe it's all about the one. If we can make a difference in one person's life, then who knows what that can lead to?
We take so much for granted in the Western world, and you know, when you visit a Compassion child and you see firsthand, you realise what is important.
We're not able to see our Compassion girls grow. We have photographs of them. Those photographs are side by side with our own daughters and our grandchildren.
Violet was quite little, and now she's 14 and growing up fast. So it's going to be quite exciting to actually see her in person.
This is, for us, a dream come true, to visit the girl that has been in our prayers, on our hearts, in our thoughts, for 11 years.
When the family gets a visit, it is actually a blessing. The child meets the sponsor, and the child can never imagine I'll ever see this person physically, apart from photos and communication in letters. But when there's this sponsor coming physically, wow, it's just breathtaking, and it's a blessing to the families.
When we were maybe 50 meters away, we could hear them. The windows were up, but we could still hear them singing their hearts out. She appeared out of nowhere. I didn't see her coming. But she just threw herself at me. And I don't think I will ever forget that moment. It was like we'd known each other ever since she was born, and that we'd been apart for so long.
You're not just sponsoring some random person who you never know anything about. Each child is known by somebody. They are cared for, they are looked after.
I think about the staff, how passionate they are to see these kids thrive and flourish.
We want to add value on these children's lives. That means economically, spiritually, they know what to do.
We only play a small part, but to see the day-to-day running of the project that provides hope, Violet. I will always remember that and remind myself that she's being cared for.
Looking at each person on that photograph that plays a part in Violet's life, and I think that's the thing that struck me. You know, it's not just us. Each member of staff plays a part in making sure she thrives, making sure she reaches her full potential. And that's what really struck me. It will really be treasured.
I realise that I can't change the world, but I know Linda and I can make a difference in more children's lives. The only thing that I know for sure is that our lives are not going to be the same again.
Excellent. And it's great to see that support that goes on. So for the younger ones that we sponsor, it's about working with the family, making sure that the children in those early years get the support that they need for their own health and the benefits of the family, making sure that those first years, which are crucial for the child's health and then obviously into school age, right up to graduation at 18, and seeing the importance of that working through the local church. And so we've got an opportunity here as local church in Lossiemouth to support the local church in the developing world as well, which is just amazing to see. And lovely to see the size of that team as well, who all go into supporting each of these children in the areas they team up with. Final question then, Adrian, can you tell us why you do the job that you do?
Well, it's really interesting. There's a little picture there. I was in Uganda just before lockdown. I was with this project of these boys that were all looking for sponsors at the time. And I'll never, ever forget this experience, because these boys were fixated with my hair. And they just wanted, because it was so different, the texture to their hair. I think they thought it was cotton wool or some substance on my head. I'll never forget it, because they would call a friend over and say, come and touch this stuff. You know, if I had a pair of scissors and they'll cut a bit, I wouldn't have any that much left. But it was so memorable. I thought it meant so much to these children, just to sort of see this strange white man and a bit of a novelty. And you know, Rab just touched on the reason, really, I guess I do this, is because to be able to take the local church here and connect it with the local church in a developing country, in the case of Lossie, with the church in eastern Uganda, to be able to invest in the lives, this is what you've done, of 19 mothers, to help them from conception, or when they know they're pregnant, to when that child is 1 to 18 months old, is a critical time if we really want to deal with this terrible issue of infant mortality, which is so high in Africa. And because of that investment that you've made, we've seen at least 19 children in this one project come through safely. And I can't emphasize enough the 19 lives. I'm not being dramatic, or I'm not over-egging this. This is so true. 19 lives have been changed as a result of the investment into the project of what we call a child survival program. And to come and meet you and say thank you for doing that is part of the reason I do this job. To be able to represent these children and come to churches, I have the privilege of going out every Sunday up and down the nation and speaking to churches and say the local church, yeah, we've got work to do in the local church here, but we also have a responsibility to the ends of the earth. And to know that what you do, prayerfully, financially, even letter writing, can save lives is no understatement. And the amazing thing today, this has not happened in the 5 years I've worked with Compassion, is that the children I've brought today, which are on a table through there, they're looking for a sponsor, are many of the children that you have helped from conception right through to when they're 1 year old. And at 1 year old or 18 months old, we then, if you like, put them up for sponsorship, because the project has done that bit, and now we're looking for a relationship between the family and the sponsor. And I just think it, you know, I didn't even plan that, Rab, to be honest. It just happened that when I said I wanted to bring children from the project, it so happened that most of them were children that you have helped come to this phase in their life, and that's not happened for me. So that's a real blessing for me to be with you, and hopefully give some of you the opportunity to maybe build up a relationship with these children through sponsorship. And who knows, Rab, maybe take a team out there one day, which is what we really do encourage in the church. Take a team of representatives to meet the project that you have invested so heavily in. Long answer, but that's what we do.
Appreciate it, and you're going to be bringing the word to us shortly, which we appreciate as well. And if you want to touch Adrian's hair, then he'll be available in the new hall afterwards, where the sponsors will be there as well. I'm just going to hand over to Willem to lead us in a time of prayer, as well as a prayer response to what we've heard about the work of Compassion. Thanks, Willem.
Right, nobody's touching my hair, I can tell you. So back off. Right. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you that you do forgive all our sins, heal all our diseases, and you crown us with loving kindness and tender mercies. We come to you as that great God of compassion and love and forgiveness, and the God who sent Jesus into the world so that we could be restored into that wonderful relationship we can have with you. Lord, we thank you for the vision and for the practical outworking of that vision in Compassion, the organization. We thank you for Adrian and for his heart for you and for these mothers and families and children in Eastern Uganda, but across the whole world. We ask, oh God, that you would bless him, bless the organization. We pray that the hearts of your people would be open to sponsorship and to prayer and to visiting and to communicating and building a relationship with folks throughout the world who, compared to ourselves, have very little and in many ways have nothing really materially. But the one thing that they can have is a relationship with you through Jesus Christ. And Father, we pray that that would always be the vision and the mission of this organization, and also that people, young people, particularly children and families, would be drawn to local churches throughout the world where they can be looked after and cared for and prayed for. Father, we thank you that you've brought us into this wonderful organization called the church. We thank you, Lord, that it has been here for age after age after age. And Father, we thank you that we are joined to those in heaven and to those throughout the earth today in that bond, in this great family that you've drawn together. And we pray, oh God, that in these days that you would continue to add people to your church in this area and also throughout the world and in places where compassion work. We pray, oh God, for that they would be able to meet the needs of youngsters and families in the areas where they work with, and that there'll be good relationships between the churches from here in the West and throughout the world. And Father, we thank you that your heart is a heart of compassion. And today we just lift up the family of Isabel Murray to you, particularly our daughter May, with her funeral this Thursday at 1:30. Lord, we know how brokenhearted people can be at the passing of a loved one. We've all experienced this. But we pray, O God, that you might pour out your spirit upon the family and they might receive strength and comfort at this time. And Father, we also pray for our fellowship here. We pray for all the organizations that are involved in this fellowship, and we pray for strength for those who run these organizations and give of their time. And we're asking, O God, that you might revive us each one and revive your church in these days. For we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. I don't quite know how to follow that. That was incredible. Teared up a bit there. Fantastic. Thanks for sharing that with us. I'm looking forward to you sharing in a minute. We're just going to sing one more song before we move into that time. So please be upstanding.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. So bless the Lord, oh my soul, You're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Your name is great and your heart is kind. For all your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I'll worship Your holy name. And on that day when my strength is failing, the end draws near and my time has come, still my soul will sing Your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore. So bless the
morning again. I was really struck when I came in today how friendly you lot are, really. You know, I go into some churches and I get looked at as if I'm a convict or something. You know, what's he doing here? Well, but to walk in here, it's so warm and so friendly. As I was setting up the table through there with the children to be sponsored and pulling up the banner I've got, a little girl, Eva, came up to me and she said, "Are you a magician?" I said, "Well, I've never been called a magician before, but I said, yeah, I guess I am, really, you know." But anyway, I'm not a magician, but I am 64 years of age. I have 3 daughters, 4 grandchildren, 1 wife, and 1 dog. And I love my dog. I do love my wife as well, my kids, my grandkids, and they know I would say that, and they're probably watching today. Folks, I'm passionate about the local church, as I'm sure you are. I'm passionate as I get the privilege of traveling around this nation and the northeast of England and sharing about the work of compassion, but compelling the church to recognize that we are God's only plan. We have the DNA of Jesus in our veins. We are it. God doesn't have a plan B. He has a plan A, and that's us. And we've been called to be His hands and His feet, to be His voice. We've been called to take what is inside each one of us, this magic, this magician's magic inside of each one of us called the Holy Spirit, and in some way impart it to those who don't know the truth. That's what we've been called to do. We're called to do a lot of other things, but essentially,
We've been called to bring hope. And we sit in a world today where the church is not as relevant, perhaps, as it was several decades ago. And we're up against a battle. We're up against a battle of choices, that our children have got so many choices on technology in front of them, and perhaps would rather be playing with their PS5, I think it is now, rather than going to church, or they'd rather be doing anything than the punishment for some kids of going to church. But we've got hope. We've got the hope within each one of our hearts. We've got the Spirit of God within us. And my message really is to compel the church to recognize that we have this relationship with the living God, and that relationship needs to be cultivated, needs to grow, as in any relationship, whether it's a relationship with my wife of 44 years married, it still has to be cultivated and grow. Or whether it's a relationship with my grown-up children or my grandchildren, it requires effort, it requires work, it requires investment in those relationships to sustain them in a world where we're being robbed every day of the quality of our time together. And it's true for the Christian. I really believe it is. It's true for you and I, that we've got the love of God in each one of our hearts. And that relationship between Father and us has to be given away and dissipated, lest we lose that love. I don't mean we lose our salvation, but we lose the passion to love, because we just keep that into ourselves. We have been designed as Christians to shine and bring hope to darkness. Now, there's a passage which many of you will be familiar with. I'm just going to read these verses from Matthew 5, verse 13. It says, "You are the salt of the earth, but if salt loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled underfoot." Then it says, "You are the light of the world. A town built on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on the stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house." In the same way, verse 16 says this, "Let your light shine before others, that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven." Let your light shine before others. Who's the others? I was in a church sharing this message some months ago, and a lady came up and she said, "I've got this prophetic word. Could I share it?" And I didn't know who she was. I'm sure it was okay. And she stood up. She said, "The problem with a lot of Christians," she said, "is that they take the light that God's given them, which is the Holy Spirit in us, and they shine it into light. And it really doesn't do a lot. We've been called to shine our light into darkness." I thought, "Oh, that's good. I'm glad to let you come up and share that. I like that. That's so true. That the call of the Christian is not to take the lamp and put it under the table where it does not give light to the room, but to put it in a room that has darkness, and to change that. If you ever imagine for a minute taking a torch and shining it in a room that's fully lit, it has no effect, but take that same torch and shine it into a room that's got no lights on, then you see the beam of light. That's us. So we've got this beam of light in us. We've got this Spirit of God within us. We've been birthed into a new life. We've got this that needs to come out, needs to emanate and impact people that are in darkness. God has given us incredible power as the children of God. And I just believe today that we need to take some steps in our lives, whether being a Christian for a short amount of time or Christian as I've been, I think, since 16. I realize that every day is a challenge to be salt, to be light, to take the Spirit of God that's in me and to somehow, through word and through deed and through just my very presence, touch someone's life. I'm believing that God is moving. You know, this is not gobbledygook. I said to somebody, a Christian, the other day, "Isn't it amazing about the power of God?" And they looked at me as to say, "Oh, you really believe that the Spirit of God moves today?" I goes, "Yeah." And I said, "Don't you?" He says, "Well," I said, "do you believe in the resurrection of Christ?" "Yeah." I said, "Well, that's a bit weird. You know, that's kind of out there. You believe in the virgin birth?" "Yes." "Well, we've got to believe that we have the power of God in our hearts to change lives." Now, what do we do with that power? When I was 8 years old, or seven or eight, I remember my parents bought me a Batman. It was either a Batman or a Superman cape. It was a red cape. And I thought as a kid that because I've got this cape on, I must have superpowers. And I remember wearing this cape to bed. I would try and wear it to school. I would wear it wherever we went. My mother would have to wash this cape, and I would have to put it back on, because unless I had the cape on, I did not have superpowers. And as a kid, I kind of believed that. And then I got a bit older and got saved, became a Christian when I was 16. And I remember really believing that I could move in that realm of the power of God affecting me. And I remember, now this is really going to sound strange, I got lost somewhere. I was not long a Christian. And I remember there's a verse in, I think it's Acts 7, where it says, Philip was with the Ethiopian eunuch, and it said, then the Spirit of the Lord snatched Philip away, and he found himself in Azotus. And I thought, that snatched Philip away. I wonder if he was kind of beam me up, Scotty. Maybe he was transported somewhere. And I thought, I wonder if God will do that, if he'll take me back home, so I don't know how to get back home. Now, you might think that's a bit strange, and it was. But I climbed into this bush that was not far from where I was, so nobody would see me. So if I was transported by the Spirit of God home, nobody would be alarmed. And I crouched in this bush, and I closed my eyes, and the wind died. And I said, Lord, by the power of the Holy Spirit in me, could you just transport me home like you did for Philip? And I opened my eyes, and I was still in the bush now. Surprise, surprise. And I looked around to make sure no one was looking at me, and I stepped out of the bush and just eventually found my way home. But I got into this kind of state that I believed the power of God was on me. And okay, I was a little bit misguided, and it was kind of baseless faith, if you like. But I always believed that the power of God was in my life. And roll on a good few years, got married, and then we were married about 6 or 7 years. I was working for a newspaper in Edinburgh, the Scotsman, and we got this tax rebate. Now, in the early 80s, it was about £800. That was a lot. It's a lot of money now, but it was a lot of money then. And I said, ooh, £800. What are we going to do with that? And my wife said these immortal words, I feel the Lord. And when your wife says, I feel the Lord, that immediately means you've lost the £800. Feel the Lord wants us to give it away to somebody. And there was a lady in the church who was in difficult age. She'd been praying for financial breakthrough. And I said, oh, but the Lord hasn't told me that, dear. And she said, he will. And it just so happened to be through her that he told me. So I took obediently this £800 and we put it into cash, and I put it in a brown paper bag or an envelope, and went past this lady's house late at night and just stuck it through her letterbox. And we just sat back and watched the power of God at work. Now, you might say, well, that's just you putting £800 through somebody's door. No, it was being obedient to my wife, who was obedient to God, and I was eventually obedient to God. And we then saw this woman begin to blossom and change. It was a catalyst. She'd been going through so many difficult times. It was fun to sit back and watch the power of God impacting her life. And it was, the catalyst to many changes in her life. And then I realized, I do have the power of God. I do have the ability, because I can hear from God. I can be receptive to the Spirit of God to bring change. That I can be used by God to change a life. And I've always believed from that day on that my words matter. That my actions matter, that my obedience to God matters, and that lives can be changed. And I guess that's part of the reason, Rabbi, I do what I do with compassion, because I can tangibly see lives being saved through a ministry which is really quite quite profound. But as Christians, God wants to use us to change lives, wants to use us to bring light into darkness of someone that's in your life. Now, it might be a family member that doesn't know the Lord. It might be somebody who's going through sickness without hope. Somebody that's going through financial difficulties without hope. somebody in your street, somebody in the community. And God has placed within each one of us the Spirit of God, which is a power, not in our words, not in our actions, but the Spirit of God flowing through us, that when we touch a situation, we have to believe that God is at work and that lives will be changed and that people will be healed, not by my strength, but by the Spirit of God that flows through me. And if that's strange to you, then you need to realize it's the truth. It's the truth. It's the Spirit of God within each one of us. We are not normal beings. We're Spirit-filled beings. We have answers in this room that can unlock the lives of so many people in Lossie Mouth. Truth is, many times we choose not to demonstrate that gift and maybe believe, oh, maybe God won't use me. They'll leave that to the elders and to the pastor. But let me tell you that the church is in the state we are today because the church isn't being relevant. The needs are still there. The needs of the world that we live in are still there. They may be complicated with technology and lots of other things, but the heart of man is still crying out for hope and for love and for acceptance and for a better way. They're trying all these things, but they're realizing that they're not being satisfied, and we've got the answer. Words are so important. My parents were born in Malta, they came over, I think, in the 50s, and illustration of how important our words are as Christians. And so we were gathering with some family members in our home, I was one of four boys in my family. And these family members, I can't remember if they came from Malta, we have some family in the States, and they said to my mother, tell us about your boys, tell us what they're doing with their lives. So we're sitting, like it was like a Bible study, and we're sitting. I was 13 years of age, and she went to one, and, oh, he's doing this, he's really good, and he's doing this, he's doing this. And it came to me, and she said, oh, Adrian, he's the stupid one. And I'll never forget that, 13 years of age. Now, I don't know whether stupid in Maltese translates to he's a wonderful boy, but at the time, I certainly didn't think that. And those words, Adrian, academically, it was probably the most challenged out of the four boys. She could have said that, but she said, Adrian, he's a stupid one. And I'll never forget it. It probably took me 10 years to get that chip off my shoulder. Now, people have had worse verbal abuse than that. I'm not in any way saying that poor old me. But she could have said, Adrian, he's the apple of my eye. What a difference that would have made. Those five words could have change my direction. Such is the importance of our words. Such is the importance of her words that she never realized what she was doing to me. That's always stuck with me because it's so, so important. So we have this light within us. We have the Spirit of God within us, folks. Something that must not be placed under the table, but on the table where it gives light. And I want you just to take a moment as I come to the end of what I want to share with you this morning, just to close your eyes if you would. And I want you to ask the Spirit of God, I want to ask God for you, to show you one person that's not a believer, or maybe is a believer, but is lost their way. And I would say, God, would you just show my brothers and sisters here today one person who is in darkness, that we can go from this place and in some way bring a word. Lord, would you just show each one of us somebody? And I pray for that person that you've shown us, that you would give us the words to say or the action to perform, but that we would prayerfully seek your face and what we should do next, because it's all about you, Jesus, about your glory. There's a verse in 1 John 5 that says, the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness shall not overcome it. The light that's in each one of our lives needs to be switched on or taken from under the table and realize that it's not about you, but it's about the Spirit of God in you. You can open your eyes. And so, I want to say that, does anybody here have an Amazon account by any chance? Few people have an Amazon. I have an Amazon account, and I have the privilege of my three daughters using my Amazon account. because I paid for the prime, if you know what I'm talking about. And one day, I got three texts from each one of the girls saying, Dad, did you buy this thing? Because they can see, for those who don't have an Amazon account, you can look on the app and you can see what people are buying. And they said, Dad, you didn't really buy an adult red cape, did you? And I said, yeah. I said, I had one when I was a child, and I would, and they're only $9.99 at Asda, on Amazon, Rab, if you want one. But I have it to remind me that I have superpowers. And my girl said, Dad, please don't wear it at church. I said, okay. I did the first couple of times, but then they saw me on stream, and they said, oh, please don't, Dad. You look stupid. Okay, I won't. But I have it in my bag just to remind me that I have superpowers, that the Spirit of God is in me, and that I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. And that's you. It's not just for the pastors, not for the elders. It's for each one of us, that we have the ability, because of Jesus in us, to make a difference. To the person that you've just thought about when we prayed. To members of the church here. When I came in here to be greeted by warmth and friendship, it does something to my spirit. Didn't take a lot for you to do that, but it worked. It made me walk away from this place and go home and speak to people and say, I've just been at Lossie Baptist. They're nice people. What a lovely place that is. As opposed to, they're rude and never spoke to me. Didn't take a lot, but it impacted and changed me. And I'm the better for walking out of this place having been in your company. Why? Because it just emanates from you. Now, imagine those people out there. We don't have to worry about, by the way, about the impact of our words and our actions. That's God's job. You know, the Holy Spirit of God does the convicting. We just have to be obedient and reach out and touch the garment of these people, as it were. Or send them a card saying, I've been thinking about you. Or take them a gift or whatever it might be. Something that's so unpredictable and so different maybe from what we are used to doing. That works. It really works. So, how do we be light? We could be light to our husbands and wives. I thank God for Aldi's. Do we have an Aldi in Lossie, man? You do. Aldi do cheap flowers. My wife loves flowers. She thinks a £6 bunch of flowers is £20, so that just suits me fine. If I take a bunch of flowers home to my wife, she thinks I'm the bee's knees. Doesn't take a lot. We could do that in our relationships with one another. We can do that with our children, our grandchildren, people in our street. We can do it with children I've brought today from Uganda, whose lives we can save and change. That's the power that God has given us. Let's pray. Father, thank you. Thank you for the privilege of being Christians. Thank you that you saved each one of us and you called us to a life full of hope, full of light. Thank you, Lord, that even in the midst of our challenges and difficulties, we can hang on to the rope of hope. Father, bless every person in this congregation and give them the boldness to move from this place and to be salt and to be light today in a situation that you have revealed to them, I pray. That we would see this place filled with people who have just found hope. Hope in Jesus. We ask it in your precious name. Amen.
Amen indeed. We're just going to sing a song as we move into a time of communion. So please be upstanding. Above all powers, above all kings, above all nature and all created things, above all wisdom and all the ways of man, you were here before the world began.
above all kingdoms, above all thrones, above all wonders the world has ever known, above all wealth and treasures of the earth, there's no way to measure what you're worth. Behind a stone, you live to die, rejected and alone, like a rose trampled on the ground. You took the fall and thought of me above all,
above all power,
above all power. Above all kings, above all nature and all created things, above all wisdom and all the ways of man, you were here before the world began. Above all kingdoms, above all thrones, above all the world has ever known, above all wealth and treasures of the earth, there's no way to measure what you're worth. Crucified, laid behind the stone, you live to die, rejected and
be seated. As this is our first communion in the morning since our members meeting last month, it's our privilege to bring in Ben and Rebecca Shepherd into membership. I just want to read from 1 Corinthians 12, similar that was at the end of that video, although a slightly different section. For just as the body is one and has many members, and all the members of the body, though many, are one body, so it is with Christ. For in one spirit we were all baptized into one body, Jews or Greeks, slave or free, and all were made to drink of the one spirit. A little bit later, further down, it says, God arranged the members in the body, each one of them, as he chose. If all were a single member, like a foot, where would the body be? It's great to really welcome and unanimously and very excitedly, Ben and Rebecca have been part of the church for about 4.5 years now. And we knocked two of that off for COVID, we were discussing this morning, so it only counts really that they haven't come to membership for 2.5 years, as far as things go. But it was so encouraging, actually, because sometimes you forget and you chase people, but it was actually Ben and Rebecca came to me and said, you know, we haven't done anything about membership, we should really do something about that. And it's a sign to us as a church. It's really a sign to us of a commitment to us. Membership's a recognition that the local church is God's design. It's to glorify him and for our flourishing. It's a sign of our recognition that God places us in the local church in order to serve him. Ben and Rebecca aren't here by accident, but they've come in service and fellowship and mission to be part of Lossie Baptist Church. And it's lovely, actually, a tradition that I haven't had before in any churches I've been in, that we always do this around the communion table, because really it's Christ that brings us together. And so it's wonderful actually to bring people into membership and then immediately to share with Ben and Rebecca around the communion table to remind ourselves how it is that we're not just part of a church until we move away, or Ben and Rebecca moves away, but we're part of a fellowship expressed locally here in Lossiemouth at the moment, but a fellowship that will be eternal. And so a million years from now, Ben and Rebecca's house, which will probably be bigger than mine, I can go over to theirs for tea and coffee in heaven, however it works, I don't know. I know there's theology problems there. But it'll be wonderful, because Christ has brought us together for eternity in a very, very special way. And so I'm just going to welcome them down to collect their very important membership certificates, get a free coffee next door after the service, and a biscuit as well. And it's just lovely to have you guys with us, I'm just going to pray with you as well. But I know most of you will know Ben and Rebecca's faces, but still make an effort to go and congratulate them. This is a really significant thing. We believe in membership. We believe it's biblical, not only in a negative and positive sense. Throughout Scripture, there are people who are removed from the church, and since all are welcome to the church, there must be something about membership there. But there's also a sense of acceptance here, of saying that we really believe in the faith of Ben and Rebecca. We really value them in the church. We think they're precious to us. And so there's also a kind of sense here, but we want to express that over tea and coffee afterwards, just to say to them, well done, welcome to the family. Whatever you want to express it as, please do express it to them that way, because this is an encouraging thing for us and for them. And we pray it'll be a real blessing as well to you. This is not a rubber stamped exercise. Please never believe that. This is a significant reflection of what God has designed for his beautiful local church. Here's your certificate for you, and I'm just going to pray for you before you can go through it. But now you've seen their faces, so no excuses over tea and coffee to pinpoint them after you've touched Adrian's hair. Let's pray together. Lord God, we thank you for bringing Ben and Rebecca to us. We thank you for their desire to show that they are rooted in this fellowship. We trust you for their future, as together as a church, we seek to serve you in this fellowship and in your world. Help us to be generous in time and gifts, giving and receiving from each other with humility and patience, encouraging and supporting one another as we walk together in our shared journey of life and faith. And we pray these things in the confidence in the name of our Savior, Jesus Christ, who is the Lord of this fellowship. Amen. Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
As I said, that brings us now to a time of our communion together. And I just want to read from 1 Peter 3, verse 18. It says, "For Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit." And a wonderful verse that we have that sums up really well why we come to this table. We come to this table because of what Christ has done in his death for our sins. This bread represents his body. This wine represents his blood. Nothing was held back by Christ, but he gave himself entirely on the cross for our sins. We're told by Peter that it's once for all. This is something that Christ has done, and he's done it to the point of completion. I often say to you, you come to this table with empty pockets. You have nothing to add to this table. You have nothing that can persuade Jesus to be more accepting of you. Your acceptance is rooted in one thing and one thing alone: believing Christ. As we'll see tonight, and happily plug tonight when we start a new series in Genesis, as we're looking at Abraham, that very important phrase, that Abraham believed God and it was counted to him as righteousness. That is an Old Testament verse that we stand on this very morning. That if you believe God, that if you trust the fact that Jesus died on the cross for your sins once and for all, then you are welcome to be reminded at this table, to be built up and encouraged at the fact that Christ has completed this work. And it was nothing that you did, and everything that Christ did for us. He took us as the unrighteous to make us righteous. And he is the righteous one, gave up his life for the sake of the unrighteous, making an amazing swap where he took our place and took the wrath of God the Father. And in place, he gives us the acceptance and eternal relationship with the Father in heaven, to bring you to God, to make you alive in the Spirit. Once again, for Christ suffered once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh and made alive in the Spirit. We invite all those who know and love the Lord as their personal Lord and Savior to come and participate at this table, to be reminded, to be witnessed to, and to witness to yourself, and to witness to the world, that Christ is everything, and he has paid the price once for all to make the unrighteous righteous. If you don't know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, then you may witness this, but we would ask politely that you just let these elements pass you by, because this is something to be done with understanding of why we're taking part in it. We'll have the prayer for the bread and the wine.
Yeah, using Psalm 103 as a basis, let's pray to God. God, our Father, we thank you that you are merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in love. We thank you, O God, that you have not dealt with us according to our sins, nor punished us according to our iniquities. And we thank you that as high as the heavens are high above the earth, so your mercy is towards us. And as far as the east is from the west, so far have you removed our transgressions from us. We thank you, O God, that as a father has compassion upon his children, so you have had compassion upon us. And we thank you, O God, that your mercy is from everlasting to everlasting to such as keep your covenant and to us who remember your commandments to do them. Lord, we thank you that your commandments are quite simple, that we are to love you and we are to love one another. And we thank you, Lord, that you showed your great love to us by sending Jesus into the world to die for our sins and to rise again to give us newness of life. And for that today, Lord, we are glad. And we thank you for the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which was given for us. And we thank you that we died in him and rose again in him by faith. And we thank you for this bread, which represents that body, which was given for us in our place. And Lord, we thank you for the blood of Christ, which was shed for us, which is represented by this wine. We thank you that that blood washes all our sins away and the shame and the guilt we feel. Lord, we pray afresh that you would come and cleanse us by the power of your Holy Spirit, and that we would have a consciousness of the power of the blood of Christ, the blood of the cross that Paul writes about, that we'll be ever conscious that 24/7 it is effectual in cleansing us and holding us and keeping us close to you. And we thank you, O God, that you are a compassionate God. And we thank you for all those arms of the Christian church, ourselves included, that seek to show the love and compassion of Jesus. And particularly upon the compassion and Adrian, we ask your blessing in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, Paul speaking to the church in Corinth says, I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. We'll take the bread as we receive it, as a sign of our, as we receive it. Full stop.
The same way he also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." And we like to hold on to the cup when we receive it and take it together as a sign of our unity in Christ. As often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Let's close our service together in prayer. After which, as you know, there's tea and coffee available next door, and we encourage you to stick around and have fellowship with us for that. But let's pray. Heavenly Father, we do thank you this morning for the reminder that we are light. We pray that you would help us to be open to your promptings, to your guiding, to your leading. We pray, Lord, we would grow in our understanding of your sovereignty too, to recognize that, Lord, even without prompt, you have placed us by purpose in the places of our work, in our communities, with our neighbors, with our family. We thank you that we are not light in our own strength, but as we've come to this table to be reminded that you are the light that shone in the darkness. You are the one who has made yourself known to us while we were in darkness, while we were unrighteous and far from you. And we thank you that the light that we shine with is a light that we have been given through Christ. We thank you for its power and authority of saving faith, that, Lord, even those who seem so far from you, who seem so unlikely, are unable to be so far removed from you that your grace and your love is not enough, that your redemption is not great enough, and that your death on the cross was indeed once and for all. Lord, we pray for those who need to know your strength in a special way, and we particularly lift up to you the family of Isabel Murray. Lord, we thank you for a life lived faithfully, well into her 90s, and though she hasn't been able to be with us these last couple of years, we thank you, Lord, that you are not the God stuck between the walls. We thank you for her part of this fellowship. And Lord, we pray for the funeral on Thursday, that you would give strength and comfort to the family, and that you would be glorified, Lord, in her funeral, just as you were glorified in her life. Now to him who's able to keep you from stumbling and to present you blameless before the presence of his glory with great joy, to the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ, our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority before all time, and now and forever. Amen.